Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I stand to speak on the first reading of the Taxation Budget Measures Bill. This bill is part of the government's overall budget package and part of the government's overall fiscal strategy. I spoke earlier today in reference to the budget that in many ways this budget is a triple deficit budget. It runs a fiscal deficit, it adds to the social deficit, and it adds to the environmental deficit. Now, I appreciate that the government inherited some deficits, no question about it. It inherited a fiscal deficit. With this budget, it's making it worse. It inherited a social deficit, and with this budget, it's making it worse. And it inherited an environmental deficit, and with this budget and with this bill, they're making it worse. But it's worth examining some of the particular measures that are being proposed in this combination of tax changes. Because I think that when the Treasurer said that we should look at the tax changes as a whole, he's got a point. We should look at the tax changes as a whole. When we look at the impact of the income tax changes, which lower the tax rates very significantly, when we combine that with the impact of the GST changes, the two of those two tax changes together are doubly regressive. When you incorporate the two elements of them, one of which lowers top tax rates and the other of which increases GST, when you put them together, what you get is a doubly regressive tax policy. And the tax changes announced in this bill will be doubly regressive for that reason. We know that GST is a regressive tax because those on the bottom decile spend about 14% of their incomes on GST, whereas those at the top spend about 4%. So GST acts as a regressive tax because it punishes the poor more than the rich. At the same time, we know that the changes to income tax will make the tax scale flatter and not as progressive as it currently is. So when you combine the two elements together, the changes to GST and the changes to income tax, you end up with a more regressive tax system. Now, that might be perhaps not the worst thing in the world if we didn't already start from a position of being one of the most unequal countries in all of the OECD. If we started from a position where there was massive equity, where there was, you know, a very flat income scale, then it wouldn't necessarily be a big deal that we flatten the progressivity of the tax system, that we increase GST. It would be a problem, but it wouldn't be a big deal. But when our starting point is that New Zealand is one of the most grossly unequal countries within all of the advanced industrialised countries on the planet, when we start from that point of view, it doesn't make any sense to introduce a combined tax package that put together is highly regressive. And it is hard to fathom why a government which is governing a country which is already grossly unequal would introduce a package that increases inequality. Now, I think that it's important to understand just how grossly unequal our country is. For example, we know that the top 50% of income earners earn 84% of all the income, and the bottom half of income earners earn 16% of all the income. 84% of all income goes to the top half, 16% of all income goes to the bottom half. When you look at those numbers, what you get a sense of is how out of touch the people in this room are. Almost everybody in this room, the people in this room, are paid well above the average wage. They have no idea that half of the country earns 16% of the income. How else could you pass a tax package which adds to inequality? How could you possibly pass a tax package, which National, ACT and the Māori Party are proposing to do today? How could those three parties support a tax package which will increase inequality in New Zealand when we already start from a position of being one of the most grossly unequal countries in all of the OECD? Why would you add to that inequality? Now, one of the justifications that the government gives is that it will increase GDP growth. Now, the Green Party is a bit sceptical about GDP growth because we recognise that we live on a finite planet and you cannot continue to grow the use of resources and the use of pollution when you live on a finite planet. There is that small issue that there's only one planet, which pretty much every other party in the House struggles to come to terms with. But let's put that to one side just to indulge the government's argument that it will grow GDP. Now we know after the last time there were very significant tax cuts, in 1986 there were very significant tax cuts, the New Zealand economy in terms of GDP per capita absolutely flatlined. It flatlined straight after the biggest tax cut package this country's ever seen. It was a huge cut. We cut from, I think it was 66 down to 33 or something like that. We went from a very high percentage down to 33. That was during the Roger Douglas years, when Labor and Roger Douglas introduced their package. And I know the colleagues in the Labor Party don't agree with that anymore and recognise the wrongs of their way back then, when Roger Douglas was in charge. But what happened after they cut the taxes so significantly? GDP flatlined. It absolutely flatlined. That was the impact. Now, I'm not saying there's cause and effect, because there's so many more complicated factors. The relationship between GDP change and income tax rates is very complicated. But you certainly cannot walk away from that and saying if you cut GDP, if you cut personal income tax rates, it results in an increase in GDP, because the exact opposite happened. Of course, the other thing that happened in 2000 was that we increased tax rates. We went from 33 to 39 for the top tax rate. And what happened? Did the economy, in terms of GDP terms, flatline? No, it grew. So we had a situation where after the increase in income tax rates, the economy grew, and after the drop in income tax rates, overseen by Roger Douglas to my left here, the economy flatlined. And so the evidence is compellingly against the argument that the government's putting forward. The second argument that's put forward is the argument around tax avoidance. This is a really interesting argument. What it says, the avoidance argument says, is that there's all these people who are using the loopholes in the tax system to avoid tax. Now, did it never occur to the government that maybe they should close the loopholes? If there's loopholes in the tax system, maybe they should close the loopholes. Now, when people avoid other laws, so if they avoid the laws, for example, around shoplifting, just to take one example, if you've got a whole bunch of people coming into your shop and shoplifting all the time, do you go, well, that's a bit of a problem. What we need to do is drop all the prices and put a fixed charge on everyone who comes into the shop in order to cover the difference. So if we go around, instead of dealing with shoplifting, instead of saying we're going to enforce the rules against shoplifting, the opposite we say is, no, obviously our prices are too high, so we're going to cut the top prices, and because we'll have less income, every person now coming into the shop will have to pay a little fee at the door. Because that is effectively what the government's doing. That is their argument around tax avoidance. Their argument says that there are people avoiding the tax, so what we need to do is cut the top tax rate rather than enforce the rules. There was another option here. The government, the National Party, the ACT Party and the Maori Party had other options other than making our tax system more regressive. The options were to enforce the tax rules as they currently existed. That is an option the government has chosen not to go down. I'd just like to talk briefly about the property tax changes. Now, the Green Party obviously has been a supporter in trying to direct a lot of our savings away from investment property, because we've got speculative boom in investment property. The obvious solution to it is a capital gains tax excluding the family home. We all know that, even though the government does not have the political courage to do what it knows should be done. The thing is that the government, there's two parts to the problems with the property, the way they've addressed property. It is far too weak. It will not have the kind of effects we're talking about. And David Cunliffe talked earlier about the LAQC loss will only be marginally affected. The other part of it is, to the extent that it puts an impact on rent, and it will, to the extent that it's effective, it will have some upward pressure on rent prices. What you have to do then is make sure that there is a supply of affordable rental properties to account for that. The Green Party has a program, for example, of massively increasing the number of affordable state houses so that we can deal with the fact that it's putting upward pressure on rents, which is what this package will do, and to make sure that there is more affordable housing available through state housing, through NGO housing and through council housing. Unfortunately, in this budget, the government has completely cut to zero, slashed to almost zero, the amount of money that's going towards new state housing. So at the time that they're proposing to put upward pressure on rents, they have cut all new building or acquiring of affordable rental state housing. Now that is just damn wrong. You can't do that. At the one time that you're going to put upward pressure on people's rental prices to the extent that your changes in property, that the government's changes in property will do that, you should make sure that there is affordable rental available. This is a budget which is inequitable. It leaves a social deficit, an environmental deficit and a fiscal deficit, and this bill is part of the problem.